Okay, we're going to talk about the birth of John the Baptist and Zechariah's prayer in Luke's gospel. So let's go to Luke chapter 1, verse 57. Luke chapter 1, verse 57. And it says that, "Now the time came for Elizabeth to be delivered, and she gave birth to a son. And her neighbors and kinsfolk heard that the Lord had shown great mercy to her, and they rejoiced with her. And on the eighth day they came to circumcise the child, and they would have named him Zechariah after his father, but his mother said, 'Not so, he shall be called John.' And they said to her, 'None of your kindred is called by this name.' And they made signs to his father, inquiring what he would have called him. And he asked for a writing tablet and wrote, 'His name is John.' And they all marveled. And immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue loosed. And he spoke, blessing God. And fear came on all their neighbors. And all these things were talked about throughout all the hill country of Judea. And all who heard them laid them up in their hearts, saying, 'What then will this child be? For the hand of the Lord was with him.'" Amazing. The moment that Zechariah publicly shared with others, "His name will be John," his tongue was loosened. He could speak again, and the people marveled. Something is going to happen with this child. You know, there's something about public witness, publicly being able to share the gospel, talk with others about Christ. And here's the first time that Zechariah publicly says something about his son and his ministry in the future, and he can finally speak. Something else important, the name John, it means literally the grace of God, Yochanan, the grace of the Lord. And so now we're going to go to Zechariah's prayer afterwards, his prayer of thanksgiving. If you go to verse 67, Luke chapter 1, verse 67, "And his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, 'Blessed be the Lord, God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. And as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us.'" Notice how the emphasis is that God has raised up a horn. In this sense, a horn means something mighty, something powerful. In this case, it's a very powerful figure. The concept of redemption is also important in verse 68. Notice that Zechariah blesses God immediately. That's his first reaction. And this should be our first reaction, to always bless God, no matter what the circumstance is. But what about redemption? Redemption has a sense of buying something, paying a price, redeeming something and paying a price so it can be bought back. And the concept is that a price has to be paid. And we're going to see what exactly this means. God is going to redeem his people from their spiritual slavery. And indeed, Jesus will pay a price for us. He will shed his blood for our salvation. So we go to verse now 71, and it says, or 70. It says in verse 70, "He spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from old." In other words, God is fulfilling the promise that he spoke regarding David and also the promises he spoke through his holy prophets. In verse 71, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us. Our greatest enemies are sin, death, and the devil. And Christ has redeemed us from all of those enemies. Verse 72, "To perform the mercy promised to our fathers and remember his holy covenant." Notice that the name Zechariah means that the Lord will remember, or God has remembered. And notice how Zechariah is talking about how God has sworn and God has remembered. And so it's so beautiful to see that the very names of Elizabeth, God has sworn, and Zechariah, the Lord has remembered. You see them in Zechariah's prayer as well. And so you go to verse 73, and it says that from 72 onward, to perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all the days of our life. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give knowledge of salvation to his people and forgiveness of their sins through the tender mercy of our God. When the day shall shine, when the day shall dawn upon us from on high, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Of course, you know that John the Baptist is going to preach repentance. It's the very essence of his message, a baptism of repentance, calling all people to repent of their sins. When one is repentant, they want to change the course of their life. They want to turn away completely from what they've been doing and turn to our Lord. And so he talks about how this child will be called the prophet of the Most High, and he will go before the Lord to prepare his ways and to give knowledge of salvation. Notice the knowledge of salvation is related to repentance. It's one of the great problems we have in our world today, that people talk about Jesus, they talk about going to church, but they're not repentant. They don't turn away from sin. And so notice this is what John will do. He will call us to repentance. And in verse 78, it says, through the tender mercy of our God. That's a beautiful term, the tender mercy. It talks about, you know, it uses a word that underlines, you know, even feelings that come from the most inward part of the human body, from the tender mercy of our God. This is the mercy that comes from the heart of God. When the day shall dawn upon us, it's a very special phrase in Greek, which is actually a reference back to the Old Testament, to a phrase that was used to talk about a future king, the Anatole, the dawn from on high, the morning sun. And so when the day shall dawn upon us from on high, when this special figure comes to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Well, my brothers and sisters, you cannot have peace unless there is forgiveness. Without forgiveness, all of your concepts of peace are superficial, completely superficial, a complete delusion. But if you have forgiveness, you can have peace. And so this is the way of peace, that in Christ we will have forgiveness. And it says at the very end of Luke chapter 1, verse 80, the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he was in the wilderness till the day of his manifestation to Israel. So notice that John was filled with the Spirit, just like Zechariah and Elizabeth, but he's living in the wilderness. He's living out in the wilderness like the Israelites who wandered in the wilderness. And it's in the wilderness that he will begin his ministry. And we finish on that note. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.